Hi, my name is Laura Jimenez. I'm a PhD student at the University of Kansas, particularly in at the Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology and the Biodiversity Institute. I want to thank the Natural History Museum for letting me participate in the Discovery Day. Today I'm going to talk about the geometry of flowers. So let's start. I'm sure you have noticed already that the world we live in is full of patterns. And today I'm going to focus on the patterns that we can find in the flowers. Nature's patterns are not just there to be admired because they are because of their beauty. By studying them, we can get to know the rules that govern natural processes. And you may ask, how can we study these patterns? Well, for me, one way to do it is through the lens of mathematics. Because mathematics are a formal system of thought that can help us to recognize, classify, and even exploit patterns. So today we will use a little bit of math to organize our ideas about the patterns found in flowers. If you are thinking right now, I'm going to pause this video because she just mentioned the word math, don't worry. You'll be perfectly able to follow me through the rest of the talk because the only thing that we're going to be using here are numbers. So a very curious pattern that occurs in the petals of flowers is called the Fibonacci sequence. This is a sequence of numbers that you can find a pattern to calculate each of the numbers that belong to this sequence just by adding the previous two elements. So for example, you look at the number 8 here, you can get it by adding the previous two numbers, which are the number 3 and 5. So 3 plus 5 is equal to 8. The number 13 in the sequence is the same as adding the previous numbers, which are 8 and 5. And by adding those, you get 13. So by following these simple rules, you can calculate lots of terms that belong to this sequence. If you pay attention next time you visit a garden or your own garden, it is very rare to find flowers with a number of petals that is not in the sequence. Almost all of the flowers follow these patterns that you are seeing in the sequence. So let me show you some examples. So the first two numbers in the sequence are 1 and 2, and we have lots of examples of single petaled flowers. The first one that probably came to your mind is the calla lily. This is very common in my country, Mexico. So put an example of it right here. And an example of a flower with two petals is this crown of thorns, and probably the two petal flowers are less common than the one petal flowers. The next number in the sequence is 3, and my favorite example is the bougainvilleas that you can see right here. These are also very common in Mexico, and I think you can find them in some places in the US. A very interesting thing about the pattern of 3, a triangular pattern, is that if you put together two of these patterns, then you end up with a double 3 structure of petals, that it is also very common in flowers. So if you look, for example, at a tulip, you have two sets of 3 petals in 2 layers. Lilies are also another example of this kind of patterns. Next, you have flowers with 5 petals, and these are the most common that you can find in nature. Even the largest known flower in the world is a 5-petal flower that you can see here on the right. And I have here some examples. This is a wax or porcelain flower, and this is a kind of hibiscus flower. The one in the middle is again a pattern in which a 5 pattern repeats twice, so you have 2 layers of petals. And in this case, they are even of different colors. Now, when you start having more and more petals, you start seeing that they are accommodated in this way, in which one petal is kind of below the next one, and you start seeing these kind of spirals. I have some examples here of flowers with 8 petals, and then with 13. My favorite example is the chamomile, because I love drinking the tea. With 21, these are very common because a lot of daisies are 21 petals. And something that I noticed while living in Mexico is that a lot of cactus flowers also have 21 petals. I have here an example of a cactus flower that is in my mom's garden. Daisies, again, have 13 or even more. There are a lot of examples out there in nature. if we now stop looking at the number of petals, we can notice something also in the middle of sunflowers. And so, for example, think of a sunflower. They usually have a very interesting pattern right in the middle. So, for example, this one is a sunflower in which you see at the florets. Florets are little flowers in the middle that are going to become into seeds at some point. So some of the spirals here are arranged clockwise and the other ones are counterclockwise. And another interesting thing here is that if you count the number of spirals in clockwise and counterclockwise way, you'll find that these numbers are also in the Fibonacci sequence. These same spiraling things are also another way to see the arrangement of petals in flowers that have many, many petals, like the chrysanthemums or the dahlias. The dahlias are the national flower of Mexico. So the petals also grow in a spiraling way and following the Fibonacci pattern. Once we have trained our eyes to recognize common patterns, the exceptions are easily spotted. It is evident that some of the numbers are far more common than others. And an example of a plant in this case that is not in the Fibonacci sequence is the clover. Clover normally has three leaves, and the superstition that a four-leaf clover is lucky reflects deep-seated belief that exceptions to patterns are special. If you want to dig deeper into this subject and find out why do we observe such a dominance of Fibonacci numbers in nature, I recommend to read this book called Nature's Numbers by Ian Stewart. He explains a little bit of why this is seen in nature. And also I would like you to watch a couple of videos if you want to know a little bit more about the Fibonacci sequence, Fibonacci himself, and where you can find these patterns in nature other than the flowers. So with that, I'm going to show you how to fold an origami flower. Hi everybody, in this video, I'm going to show you how to make an origami tulip. I choose this very simple origami model. You're gonna need two pieces of paper, a green one to make the stem of the flower, and you can choose whatever color you want. In this case, I have a pattern in my paper with a white side. So let's start by folding the flower. It's going to be very simple. You're gonna turn over the paper so the white side is up, then you're gonna fold by through one of the diagonals of the square, so you end up having a triangle like this. And then we're going to fold it again in a half to make a smaller triangle, but instead of folding it entirely, we're going to make just a pinch to mark right in the middle. And with that, you're gonna use that mark as a reference to make a fold up. In this case, notice that you're going to fold not until the edge of the paper meets the line in the middle, but you're going to make a slight angle in which you can start seeing the different petals of the flower. So you do it on one side and then on the other side. And once you fold it in both of the sides, you're gonna turn over the paper and you're gonna make a slight fold of these opposite corners like this. Fold them the middle and the opposite also towards the middle. And after this, you are done. This is your tulip. Now let's fold the stem. So take your green piece of paper and we're going to fold again using one of the diagonals of the square to end up with a triangle. After this, you're going to open the paper and we're going to be using the line in the middle as a reference. First, you're going to fold until this side of the paper matches the line in the middle, like this. And you're going to repeat this exact fold, but in the opposite side. So now you take the other side of the paper to the middle line. Okay, now you can see that we ended up with this kite shape. We're going to repeat this kind of folds, but in the other side of the paper. So now we're going to be taking these sides of the paper. We're going to fold them towards the middle line. And we're going to do it one more time. Again, take this side of the paper, take the edges, and fold them towards the center. Okay, after this, we're going to make a fold that divides this long line in half. So we're going to put this corner of the paper and this one together. This. Okay. And now take the line that you have in the middle and we're going to fold in a half. Like that. Okay. Once you do that, you're going to see that two little pieces of paper come apart here in this corner. So you're going to take the one that is inside and you're going to push it a little bit until you have a larger angle. And then just mark the folds of the paper. And there you go. This is the stem of your flower. And you already have your tulip. So if you want to put the stem inside the flower, you can just make a little cut here on the bottom. And then put the stem in the middle. There you go. And that's it.